Hi everyone, today I'm going to present a brief introduction about the turbulence. In this presentation, first I'm going to answer the question that what is turbulence? After that, the definition of Reynolds number is given. As you may know, the Reynolds number is the most important parameter for the characterization of the turbulence. Next, I talk about the relationship between the turbulence and the energy cascade concept. And finally, I will discuss the turbulence CFD simulations. So, let's see, what is turbulence? Turbulence is in fact a state of the fluid which is random, chaotic, and three-dimensional. Therefore, an important point here is that the turbulence is not a fluid property, but it is a property of the flow itself. Turbulence results in increased energy dissipation, mixing, heat transfer, and drag. For instance, this figure shows the presence of the turbulence in a smoke from a cigarette. The transition of the laminar flow to the turbulent flow can be clearly observed. The turbulence characterization is most famously attributed to the work by Osborne Reynolds 1894, who performed a series of experiments at the University of Manchester. Colored dye, which here is shown by blue, was injected into water flowing through a transparent pipe. Reynolds noticed that as the velocity increased, the fluid flow pattern altered from a straight line to a series of eddies due to increasing of the flow velocity. The straight line refers to laminar flow, while the eddies refer to turbulent flow. When the flow behaves like in the first observation, this is known as laminar, and in the second, it is turbulent. It was found that the turbulent flow structures are related to the ratio of inertial and viscous forces. This is denoted by the dimensionless group of variables, which includes velocity, and length scales characteristics of the flow and the fluid density and viscosity, which has become known as the Reynolds number, as shown here in this equation. Rho is the fluid density, right? U is the flow velocity. L is a characteristic linear dimension. Mu is the fluid dynamic viscosity, and nu is the fluid kinematic viscosity. As mentioned, the Reynolds number in fact represents the ratio of inertial forces to viscous forces. To explain further, consider the flow, the fluid flow over a flat plate as shown in this figure. In this case, the characteristic length in the Reynolds number, as shown here, is defined as the distance from the leading edge of the flat plate. For low Reynolds numbers, which is equivalent to small distances from the leading edge, where viscous forces are dominant over the inertial forces, the particles in the layer closest to the plate encounter skin friction and slow down. They apply a retarding shear force to the layers immediately above them, which slows them down too. As can be seen from the figure, this results in a velocity gradient normal to the plate, as shown here and here. Now, as the flow progresses down the flat plate, the boundary layer thickens. This is equivalent to an increase in the Reynolds number. With the thickening of the boundary layer and increasing the flow velocity, the inertial forces finally overcome the viscous forces, and the laminar flow transitions into the turbulent flow. This transition happens for Reynolds numbers larger than 5 times 10 to the power of 5. If we repeat the experiment performed by Reynolds over this flat plate, the colored dye follows a trajectory like the one as shown in this figure with the blue line, right? This trajectory. In the laminar part, the trajectory is a straight line, while in the turbulent part, the trajectory is random and chaotic. The nature of turbulence in a fluid flow can be understood by the energy cascade. This hypothesis states that the turbulent flows are characterized by a large range of vortical structures or eddies at different scales, both in time and space, which interact with each other and exchange energy, as shown in this figure for the flow over a flat plate, which shows that the turbulent flow is characterized by a large range of vortical structures or eddies. A generic turbulent kinetic energy spectrum that indicates how the turbulent energy is partitioned among the various size of eddies is shown here. The wave number is inversely proportional to the turbulent length scale. It can be seen that most of the turbulent kinetic energy is in the large turbulent length scales or low wave numbers. The energy cascade can be explained using this figure. In this figure, the ovals and circles indicate the eddies of various length scales. The largest scales contain most of the kinetic energy of the flow. As larger structures are broken into smaller ones, this energy is transferred to progressively smaller scales. The process of energy transfer from large to small scale is called direct energy cascade, and it continues until the viscous dissipation can convert the kinetic energy into thermal energy. The scale at which this occurs is referred to as Kolmogorov length scale, after the mathematician Andrei Kolmogorov, who worked on the energy cascade in turbulence. Kolmogorov developed a relation for the rate of dissipation of the smallest eddies with the following length and time scales, respectively. Here, in these equations, epsilon is the dissipation rate of the smallest eddies, and nu is the fluid kinematic viscosity. Thus, the smallest scales of eddies are also referred to as the Kolmogorov scales, which are shown here. As engineering flows are mostly of turbulent nature, when dealing with CFD simulations, most of the time we need to solve turbulent flows. The modeling of turbulence constitutes one of the most important aspects of CFD modeling, and correctly modeling turbulence is the key in obtaining correct and reliable CFD results. CFD is employed to solve the Navier-Stokes equations, which govern the turbulent flow motion. CFD often uses three different methods for the solution of the Navier-Stokes equations for turbulent flows, which are direct numerical simulations, which here is shown by DNS, large eddy simulations, LES, and Reynolds average Navier-Stokes equations, RANs. I have explained briefly these methods in another video in my channel named DNS, LES, and URANs. Before I explain the difference between these methods, it is worthy to have a general idea of the degree of accuracy of these methods in the prediction of a turbulent jet, which is shown in the following picture. As can be seen, DNS provides a very accurate model-free representation of the unsteady evolution of the turbulent flow. In fact, a properly designed DNS resolves all the temporal and spatial turbulence scales down to the chromograph scale without using any modeling techniques. For CFD computation, in order to resolve all the turbulent flow structures, the control volume size and time step must be of the same order as the chromograph length and time scales respectively. This is exactly what DNS does. Here I'm going to give you an example to have an idea about the computational cost of a DNS simulation. A typical flow domain of 0.1 by 0.1 meter with a high Reynolds number turbulent flow might contain eddies down to 10 to 100 micrometer size. Let's put it into context. Here I'm showing you an eddy with the size of 100 micrometer. To resolve this eddy, we need at least 4 mesh cells as shown here. From the velocity vectors shown here, it can be concluded that this is the minimum possible resolution we can use to resolve an eddy. This actually allows us to give a numerical representation of an eddy. This means that the minimum spatial resolution that we can use for this case is 50 micrometer, which is equivalent to at least 10 to the power of 7 mesh cells for a computational domain as small as 0.1 by 0.1 meter. The challenge does not end here. The frequency of these small is the frequency of these small eddies is on the order of 10 kilohertz. So we would need to discretize the time into steps of about 100 microsecond. The DNS method is computationally very expensive, not only due to the space and time scales mentioned above, but also in order to accurately resolve the small scale motion, it needs to employ high order discretization schemes that most general purpose commercial CFD solvers do not have such schemes. For these reasons, alternatively, less demanding turbulence modeling methods are employed. Large eddy simulation, LES, employs a filtering approach on the basis of the control volume size. LES, in fact, resolves the important large eddies while it models the influence of the smaller eddies on the large eddies. LES is computationally less expensive than DNS, but it still needs fine mesh and small time step to appropriately resolve the flow. Finally, we have the Reynolds average Navier-Stokes equations, which are represented as the RANS. And the RANS is less demanding in terms of computer resources than the previous two methods. The RANS equations arise from ensemble averaging, not time averaging, of the Navier-Stokes equations, in which the instantaneous flow variables are decomposed into the mean parts and fluctuating parts using the Reynolds decomposition technique. In these equations, the turbulence effect is represented through the Reynolds stresses, which are modeled by turbulence models. In other words, the RANS equations provide the mean flow characteristics, where the turbulence effect on these mean flow characteristics is accounted for through turbulence modeling. In the next video, I'm going to talk more about the ensemble averaging and its difference with the time averaging, together with the various Turbulence modeling schemes that are used in Rand's turbulence modeling context. The difference between DNS, LES, and Rand's can also be explained using the turbulent kinetic energy spectrum as follows. A properly designed DNS resolves all the temporal and spatial turbulence scales down to the Kolmogorov scale without using any modeling techniques. LES resolves the important large eddies while it models the energy transfer from large to small scales. Note that the cutoff wave number, as shown here, it is the cutoff wave number, right? Separating the resolved and modeled length scales is usually found in the inertial range prior to the dissipation range. And finally, we have the Rand's method, right? Where the turbulence is accounted for by modeling the effect of all the turbulence scales on the mean flow. So the summary of what I talked about in this introduction to turbulence, we learned that what turbulence is and how it is characterized. We also understood the concept of energy cascade and its relation with turbulence. And finally, we learned how to account for the turbulence in a CFD simulation. This is the end of this video. I hope you found this video useful. Please let me know what you think about this video by leaving a comment in the comment section. Thank you for watching the video, and for further upcoming videos, please subscribe to this channel.